Church Online at North Rock. We're really glad you're here with us today as we finish out our series, Who is Jesus?
Whether you're watching from Michigan or California, whether you're YouTube or Facebook, go ahead and check in with us by saying hello in the chat. You know, we have an online host there and they are ready to greet you, answer any questions that you might have about our church, and most importantly, they want to get you connected with a pastor who can pray with you today.
Yes, and the best way to watch our services with the most access is just a click away in your address bar at northrock.online.church. If you're not already there, check out the chat for a link to join in.
Well, today is Palm Sunday, and we've got an incredible Easter service planned for you next week, and we believe God is ready to move in the hearts of those who are going to be tuning in. So invite someone to church.
Yes, it's never too late to drop an invite in someone's inbox with a friendly hello and an encouraging word. Just let them know what service you plan on attending and let God do the rest. All right, our worship team is ready for us, so let's lift up those voices and praise.
There is a hope that washes the fear away. There is a peace that settles around us. It is your love that sets our hearts ablaze. Father, we're on our knees with every heartbeat we bring you this offering. Lord, come and fill this place. Father, we're crying out. Spirit, we need you now. Glorious love surrounds us. Lord, come and fill this place. There is a king who reigns in victory. There is a mercy strong enough to save. We feel it rising up from the ashes. It is your love that overcame the grave. I will worship you, I'll worship you. this place. Father, we're crying out. Spirit, we need you now. Open your spouse alone. It's how we worship you. How we worship you. How we worship you always. And I will worship you. I will worship you. I will worship you always. And I will worship you. I worship you. And I will worship you. I'll worship you.
I'll count on one thing, the same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. And in the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, fail me now, you won't fail me now. And in the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out.
Choose to praise, to glorify God.
got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end. So I'll throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing. Just one more. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you.
Yeah. Has anyone ever told you that you sound so good? You're like, Jason, I don't know. I don't know if I can really sing that good. Listen, this is important that you know this. When we lift our praise to God, it is a pleasing aroma to Him. The Bible says, make a joyful noise. It's about the joy that's in your heart. And as we were worshiping today, one of the things that popped out in my head was really this passage in Hebrews 28, where the Bible says this, therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence, awe, and gratitude. Man, when we take a second just to allow the gratitude in our hearts to be expressed through worship to God, it is a sweet smell to the nose of God. It is meaningful to the heart of God. I love that we get to do that each week, week in and week out here at Church Online. We're going to continue our worship today through a time of giving. And this is a time when we affirm our trust in God as the provider and the giver of every good thing in this life. You know, for the month of March at North Rock, we had it on our heart to let that gratitude inside us overflow and make a difference in the life of foster families and foster children this month. We've gotten word recently that there's been an increased number of kids that are going into or needing foster care. And so as a church, we've got people inside of our church that are currently caring for those children, and also people outside of our church, organizations even, that we would love nothing more than to be a blessing to this month. And we're a tithing church. So the first and best of everything given at this church goes immediately out the doors to make a difference in someone's life. And that's the difference that your giving is going to make in the month of March. You can give today in two ways. First off, you can click the giving link in the chat or the comment section on Facebook. Or you can text the keyword NRGIVES to 77977. Again, you can use your mobile device today to give simply by texting the keyword NRGIVES to 77977. As you prepare to give today in whatever fashion that you're able to participate, I would love to pray over that gift, that God would use it in a mighty way, but that He would bless your life for letting your gratitude overflow into generosity and making a difference in the life of another. Will you pray with me today? God, thank You as always for all of the blessings in our life. We're grateful that we are part of a kingdom that cannot be shaken. That no matter how crazy things might look in the world around us, we know that our salvation, our security, our peace, our trust, our hope is founded in You. God, today, we let that gratitude in our hearts overflow into generosity as we bring these gifts now to You. We ask You to use them, to multiply them, to share hope and make the name of Jesus known through these gifts today. God, we pray for foster children and foster families this month. Those that maybe are coming into foster care for the first time. We ask, God, that as a church, we could make a profound difference through this generosity and this giving this week. That it would go forth and share the hope and love of Jesus with those that need it so much. And God, I pray for every giver today. I thank You for their courage to be generous and their heart to make a difference. Bless their life for the blessing that they are to others. We thank You and we give You the praise. In Jesus' name, we pray. And all of God's people said, amen.
The Bible is God's word to us. When we read or listen to it, it tells us what's true and helps us live a better life. The Bible app can give God's word a voice in your life every day. You'll find thousands of free devotionals, videos, and more, all designed to help you explore what the Bible says. Discover together with friends and share your journey along the way. Get the Bible app today at bible.com/app.
Do you want to read your Bible more? At North Rock, we are starting a new reading plan using that YouVersion Bible app, and it's called The Way, the Truth, and the Life. It's going to follow along directly with today's message. And here's a verse from the study. Everyone who goes ahead and does not abide in the teaching of Christ does not have God. Whoever abides in the teaching has both Father and Son. Now that is the redirecting traction that we need to start our week. If you haven't friended up North Rock Church yet on the YouVersion Bible app, just see the chat for an invitation to this week's plan. Hey, Pastor Jason, we are ready for the final week of Who is Jesus?
There's a lonely arena in the depths of your heart where the greatest battle of life must be fought alone. That's your decision about Christ. Your parents can't make it for you. The church can't make it for you. Your friends can't make it for you. Your girlfriend, your boyfriend can't make it for you. You have to make it yourself. There are two destinations, one toward heaven and one toward judgment and hell. And you're on one road or the other. If you're on the broad road that leads to destruction and judgment, I'm asking you to change roads and go the narrow road that leads to eternal life. And that means you must come by way of the cross.
Goodness, it's you. Hello and welcome everybody to Church Online. We're so glad that you are here today. For those that don't know, my name is Jason Tucker. I'm one of the pastors here, and we're excited that you're joining us in week number 4 of our series called Who is Jesus? We'll get to that in just a second. If you're new or you're visiting with us today, let us know you're here in the chat or the comment section on Facebook or our Church Online platform. Just type out, hey, I'm watching from, or hey, I'm checking out Church Online for the first time. We've got a group of people there, a host team of people and some pastors that would love the opportunity to meet you today. Answer any questions maybe that you have about our church, or even be an encouragement to your life today if you need prayer or whatever it might be. We're just really glad that you're here today. So we're continuing on in a series today called Who is Jesus? And we've been taking a look every single week at this profound question, really, that Jesus asked his disciples. And now if you've missed any of these messages, I would encourage you to go back to our YouTube channel. You can find them all in their entirety there. And it's just a great way to lead up to Easter weekend. And so I definitely want to put a plug in to say, hey, make sure that you invite someone to Easter at North Rock Church. Bring them along with you. Watch church in your living room with them. Invite them to a coffee shop. You know, Easter is that time of year where most people, statistics show that almost 89% of people would be willing to come to church if someone simply invited them to come. And so I'm charging you today to be that person. Let's get out there and find someone to lead to Jesus this Easter. As we jump into today, you know, we're really answering that same question that Jesus asked his disciples one day. He asked them, you know, who do people say that I am? And there were a lot of different answers to that question. We've been looking at that each week. And even Jesus had some different answers
to that question, but what we've been dialing into every week is really this personal piece of this question, who is Jesus? I believe all of us have to personally answer this question for ourselves, whether you know the answer or whether you don't. I think there's always a deeper understanding of these three simple words, who is Jesus? And that's why Jesus asked his disciples that day, but what about you? What about you in this moment? Who do you say I am? Now, Jesus made a lot of claims about who he was. In particular, there were seven I am statements in the Bible. We've been studying those. Today we're going to look at one more of those I am statements. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. What does that mean to us? He's the way, the truth, and the life. It's, you know, like in our life today, in the year 2021, what does that mean to help me answer this question, who is Jesus? Let me try to explain it this way. My family recently went on a vacation to the Wisconsin Dells. Now, I've never been to the Wisconsin Dells before this, but one of the things that I've noticed is, like, you know, going on vacation, it's like, man, you get so excited, worked up and pumped up and planned up to go out and have a great vacation. And I'm going to tell you what we did. We had a great time at the Wisconsin Dells, water parks. Man, we played gigantic pool with soccer balls and big arcades. You know, we hit the ski hills. My goodness gracious, like, took pictures at the picture booth. And you know me, I'm a pizza connoisseur. Man, we had some good pizza at Wisconsin Dells, you know, and smiles all around, you know, like from the family. We're having a blast, you know. But one of the most interesting things to me recently is we get all prepped up and ready and go on these vacations. But for some reason, after about 2 or 3 days on vacation, whether it's me just getting older or what, I don't know how to explain it, but honestly, I just want to go home. It's not that I'm not having a great time on vacation. Obviously, we are. You can see the smiles. You can see, man, the pizza, the water slides, everything. Why is it that after being away from home on vacation, that really there's this deep desire at some point to be like, man, I just want to get home. I just want to sleep in my own bed. I just want to get back into my routine. The vacation was fun, but man, I'm ready to go home. I've got this picture at my house. It was actually the people that built my house put this picture up on the wall. It's like it was taken when the house was first built. So it looks way different now, obviously, but you know, this picture came to my mind when we were in the Wisconsin Dells. I had walked by it one day. It's in our mud room as you're leaving my house. And I just thought, you know, man, as much fun as I'm having on this vacation, I'm just ready. I'm ready to go home. You ever felt that way? You know, I think when Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, he says that on the heels of a statement that he makes where he's preparing himself to go home. He's even starting to have a desire to go home. And in this moment, it's leading him up to one of the most painful times in his life. He's 24 hours away from laying his life down on the cross. And he's got to walk through that difficult season in order to get home. And that's where we pick the story up in John 13. It was just before the Passover festival. Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. He's like, man, the time has come. It's been real. It's been fun. It ain't been real fun. But hey, I'm ready to go home. It's time to go home, he said, having loved his own who were in this world. That's his disciples and those who were following him. He loved them dearly. He didn't want to leave them, but he wanted to and needed to go home. He loved them to the very end, it says. John 14, 1 through 6 says this. Jesus is talking to his disciples about his trip home. He washes their feet. You've probably heard that story in some capacity. It kind of freaks them out a little bit. They're like, man, what is going on? 24 hours before he's going to die, he tells them, hey, I just want to prepare you. I'm getting ready to go home. And obviously that news is shocking to them. They don't even necessarily understand what it means. So he reassures them, don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, which is great, but believe also in me. Listen to that again. You believe in God, he's telling the disciples, and that's a good thing. You believe in God, but you should also believe in me. I'm getting ready to go home. I've been with you. You need to believe in me. Not just God, believe in me. And so the story continues. My Father's house, he tells them, has many rooms. And if that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? In other words, I am ready to go home, but I'm going home for the purpose of preparing a place for you to come with me, for you to be with me, for us to be there together. He said, believe in me. You can trust me on this. He goes on to say, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back. I'm going to be gone for a little while. I will come back and take you to be with me in that place that you also may be where I am. I want you to be where I am. We're going to go home together. And he says, you know, watch this, key word here, the way. You know the way, he says, to the place where I'm going. Now, in that room that day, there was a whole lot of confusion by these words of Jesus. He had told them that he was going to have to lay his life down. He had shown them that he was going to lay his life down for them through serving them and washing their feet in that moment, but they completely missed it. They did not get it. Swing and a miss. They didn't understand. He said, you know the way. Come on, you know the way to the place where I'm going. You know how to go with me. You know how to go home with me. Thomas was there that day. Come on, doubting Thomas. How would you like to be known for the one time? He had a few times in scripture, but pretty much every time Thomas shows up in scripture, he is like Eeyore, right? He's kind of, he doubts. And obviously, I kind of find some Thomas in me sometimes in my approach to God. But Thomas says this, Lord, we don't know where you're going. Like, you're talking in riddles, man. I don't have a clue what you're talking about. So how can we know the way? How can we know the way to where you're going? I don't even have any idea what you're talking about. Watch, Jesus answered him. I am the way. He said, I'm going home. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And it's important that you know this. You already know the way. Thomas says, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't even know where you're going, so how would I know how to get there? Jesus said, I am the way. I am the way and the truth. And what does that say? The life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now, let me pause there for a second and just say this. This is another one of those moments where Jesus makes a very audacious claim. A claim that many people, even today, struggle with. He's saying the only way to get home, the only way to get home, connected to God, back to God. In my Father's house, there are many rooms, and I'm going there to prepare that place for you. And you know where I'm going, and you know how to get there. You know the way to get there. Let's be honest, in society today, what we've convinced ourselves is that there are many ways to God. There are many people that believe that. Well, I mean, you know, what I believe is if my good outweighs my bad, then I'll be there. Well, how do you know? How do you know if your good outweighs your bad? You don't have a good and bad meter in your pocket. I mean, there's no, you can't be sure of that. Well, you know what I mean? God is love and he loves everybody. And so there's no way that he would ever send anybody to hell. Again, I don't see that in scripture. So Jesus, you know, obviously there's a way there. That means you need to know the way. You need to know and understand how to be there, how to be where Jesus is. And so, you know, obviously there's a lot of different things in different religions that believe different things, you know, when it comes down to how you're going to spend eternity with God, how you're going to make it home after this life is over. Jesus makes an audacious claim. You can't get there without me. I'm the way. I'm the truth. I'm the life. No one comes to the Father. No one makes it home without me. Man, I know there's a lot of tension in that. And I think a lot of people are asking the question, well, then what is Jesus saying here? Like, give me the essence, Jason. What is he actually saying in that moment? What's he trying to communicate to the disciples who he cares about and loves? I mean, well, have you ever seen those like before I die walls? Like, or have you ever heard of the bucket list, right? Like, before I kick the bucket, this is my list. You know, when you think about it, the before I die walls, people write up there, things I want to do before I die. And we write some audacious, crazy things up there. I want to fly, you know, like outside of an airplane with wings. I want to, you know, I went skydiving, right? Come on, some Tim McGraw. We write some things up here like, I want to land on the moon. Like, what would I like to do before I die? Well, what Jesus says he wants to do before he dies is prepare you a way, prepare you a room in the Father's house and show you the way how to get there. Even when you don't know, like Thomas, when you say, I don't have a clue what you're talking about. I don't understand. And if I don't understand, how would I know the way? What did Jesus say? I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. And that was kind of his bucket list, is that they would understand no one comes to the Father except through me. So what's Jesus saying? I think he's saying this. I am the one and only way to God. Period. No discussion on the topic. Whether that upsets you, whether you agree or disagree, Jesus is making a claim here. He's saying the only way you get home, the only way you get to be with God is through him. And it's backed up throughout scripture in many different places. It wasn't just a claim that Jesus made. Look, Acts 4:12, salvation is found in no one else. It's not found in being a good person. It's not found in making sure that, hey, out of 52 weeks, I went to church 51. Hey, we only went on vacation 1 week. That's not what's going to get you to church or get you to heaven. Get you to church, that's a whole nother deal. That's not what's going to get you to heaven. That's not what's going to get you home where you belong with God. There's salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven. No other name given to mankind by which we must be saved. Think about it this way. Obviously, you know, you've probably at some time in your life or another experienced the battery on your car dying. And what you've learned about life up until this point is death is inevitable, right? And again, if you drive your car around in the wintertime and you don't change your battery, obviously your battery eventually will be gone. And so what we've learned when our battery runs out on our car is there are many ways that I can solve that problem, right? I mean, I can call AAA and they will come and jump my battery and they'll get me back on the road, roadside assistance. I can have somebody else at the store hook jumper cables up and jump my battery and help me. I can carry one of these little boxes in my car that basically I can charge up on my cigarette lighter in my car and I can walk out and hook it up and it'll help my car get started too. Or I could just go buy a new battery and keep it in my car. All of these solutions would fix the problem. But see, that's the approach we take to God as well. We think, well, Jesus says he is the way. What he really means is he is a way. There are other ways. There are other options on the list for after I'm gone. There are other options on the list for after life is over. And what Jesus is saying is that is completely not correct. I am the only, one and only way to God. And then he continues, doesn't just stop there. He says, I'm the one and only portrait of God. I'm the truth. I am the truth. Like, if you want to see God, you're only going to see what God is like, his character, his nature, his approach towards you, his love for you. You're only going to see that by looking at me. Again, remember, he's telling this to a group of people that have pretty much been religious since birth. You claim to see God. You know God. What did he tell him earlier? You know God, but you need to know me. Also, you need to understand, you know God and that's good, but you need to know me. The only way that you're going to experience, see God for who God really is, know God's character or even understand God's approach towards you, his grace, his mercy, his forgiveness, his love, his power in your life, is to look at Jesus. You got to look at Jesus. Everything outside of Jesus is a fake. Let me say that again. Everything outside of looking at Jesus is a fake, according to Jesus. He's saying, audaciously, he's saying, I am the one and only portrait of God. You can't see God, experience God. You can't get to God. You can't know God outside of knowing and seeing me. You will see the truth revealed about God through my life. Again, here it is in Scripture, Colossians 1. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. You can actually see him. When you pick up a Bible and you dig into these pages and you read about Jesus, you're seeing the visible representation of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on the earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see. What Jesus knew when he told him this is this, that if he didn't come and give them this information straightforward, that they would settle for a counterfeit version of God. They would settle for a misrepresentation, a fraud, if you will, even in some cases, of who God was, how God was, the character and nature of God. I don't know if you've seen this special on Netflix yet, but it's called Made You Look. And the special is all about the fraud that exists in the art industry. How people will take a painting and literally create a replica of the painting, and it'll look a lot like the painting. To the naked eye, to you and I, we won't even notice the difference. But what's crazy is, I'll let the promo tell you the story. I'll show you a promo for this. It's definitely something worth watching. It's literally a multi-billion dollar industry. One of the nation's most revered art galleries had to shut down because of the fraud that was existing, because of the amount of people that were duped by art that looked like the original art, but actually was a fake. Check this out.
An $80 million scandal has the art world up in arms tonight.
A series of fakes that sold for tens of millions of dollars.
It takes more than a really talented con man to pull off a forgery of this magnitude.
She comes in off the street with supposed masterpieces in the trunk of her car.
An absolutely bizarre story for any dealer to accept.
These works went into the greatest museums in the world.
Either the paintings are all real or they're all fake.
We all know how that story turned out.
I was fooled. I believe the paintings were absolutely real.
How could you devise such a scheme?
The con is on. This is why Jesus made the claim. The con is on, right? In the art industry, this was the con. There are things that look the same, right? There are things that to you and I, they might look the same, but Jesus is saying, I don't care what anybody tells you about God. If you want the truth about God, look at me. I'm the one and only portrait. I'm the one and only original. I'm not a fake. I'm not a phony. And again, this claim was being made to people who all of their life had believed in God. Think about that. Think about how mind-blowing and confusing that must have been in that moment. You know, I think the third thing Jesus was trying to get at with them, I'm the only way you're gonna get to God, one and only. I'm the one and only portrait of God. You're only gonna see the truth about who God is by looking at me. I think the last thing was this: life in me is the one and only life that won't leave you wanting. Life in me, he's saying, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Life in me is the only life you can live that won't leave you wanting. Solomon was king of Israel, or he was a king of Israel, and I would say revered as one of the wisest kings in the history of the nation. He asked God for wisdom, not money, fame, or power, and God blessed him with wisdom and gave him all of the other things in addition to that because of what he asked for. And this was the conclusion that Solomon came to when he looked at life, when he studied life, when he looked at all of the pursuits of life, all of the pleasures of life, all of the things that you could wrap your life around or try to find your fulfillment in. And here's what he had to say. Rivers will run into the sea, but the sea's never full. He said, then the waters return again and the rivers flow out again of the sea or to the sea. Everything is wearisome beyond description. No matter how much we see, we're never satisfied. No matter how much we hear, we're never content. Jesus knew something about life that needed to be communicated to the disciples that day that I guarantee, to some degree, you and I are experiencing in our life today. Of all the pursuits and desires in life, of all the things that we seek after, we go after, sex, success, relationships, money, power, things that we think are going to, if we can just get enough of it, I won't be found wanting. I won't feel empty anymore. If I can just get a better relationship, if I can just get a bigger bank account, if I can just get a better job or more power or prestige, or if I can just find more sex to have in my life or more success, I will finally be fulfilled and I will not be left wanting. Jesus said, no, 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 that's not the way that that works. I am the only thing. I'm the life. Life in me is the only life that will leave you not left wanting. I love how C.S. Lewis explains that. He says this. He says, if I find in myself desires which nothing in this world can satisfy, the only logical explanation is that I was made for another world. I want to say that again because I want you to let that sink in today because I think that really sums up this statement that Jesus made. If I find inside of myself desires that the world can't satisfy, the sex, the success, the relationships, the power, the money, if there are desires in me the world can't satisfy, that should tell me something. Everything I pursue in this life always leaves me wanting. It always leaves me empty. It always leaves me needing more. And Jesus is saying, I am the only thing in life that's not going to leave you wanting. The only logical explanation to those kind of desires is I was made for another world. You were made to go home. That's the deep desire in you. It's like I said earlier, when you're on vacation and you're having the time of your life and you're, man, this is a blast. I'm having the time of my life. But after 3 days, 4 days, maybe it's a week for you. Maybe you like being away longer, 10 days, whatever it is. Eventually you come to that place where you're like, oh, man, I just want to go sleep in my own bed. The money's run out, the pleasure, it was good, but now it's not as good. Kind of lost its flavor a little bit. The success, that promotion that I built my life on that I thought was going to be the thing, man, it's just not the thing anymore. The bank account, the money that I had, it's gone. It just doesn't fulfill. Bold claims by Jesus. But what does it mean to you and me today? What does it mean in this moment, in the year 2021, where we find ourselves now? Jesus said this now thousands of years ago. But what does it mean to me and you today? Well, I think the first thing, just really two things. I think the first thing is this. More of what's not fulfilling me now is not going to fulfill me later. Come on, let's be honest. We all need to write that down. We all need to write that down. That's refrigerator material. Remember when you brought your a good grade card home from school and moms would put the grade card on the refrigerator? That is refrigerator material for our lives. When you think about what Jesus said and you consider it for your life and mine right now in the year 2021, what we need to grab a hold of is more of what's not fulfilling me now, more sex, more success, more relationships, more money, like it's more power, more prestige, more of what's not fulfilling me now is not gonna fulfill me later. It's not. That's not the answer. Jesus is right. I've pursued the more. I've chased the more. I went after the more. I spent my life trying to fulfill that endless hunger and desire, and all I ever found myself was wanting. Anybody else out there? Is that your story? Man, I know it's mine. That's my story. That's why when you hear those words of Jesus, that's why they're just so profound even today. Let me show you this in scripture. Jesus said, if any of you wants to follow after me, if you want to come after me and go towards the place that I'm preparing for you, if you want to come home, he says, if you want to be my follower, you have to give up your own way. Your way of chasing your desires and trying to fulfill them, it's never going to satisfy. He's saying you have to give up your own way. You have to take up your cross. In other words, you have to embody this idea, more Jesus, less me. Right? I have to die to myself. More Jesus, less me. That's the only answer that's going to leave me not wanting in life. And follow after me. He said, if you try to hang on to your life, you're going to lose it. If you try to hang on to your life, if you build your life on those desires and thinking that's going to be the answer, you're going to lose home. You're going to lose your life. But if you give up your life for my sake, if you push those desires aside and you find your desire in me, you're actually going to save your life. You're going to save it. And then here comes the mic drop moment. He says, what do you benefit if you gain the whole world, but you lose your soul? What do you gain? Is anything in this life, is anything in this world worth more than your soul, where you're going to spend eternity? If you're going to be able to go home, is anything more important in life than that? I think if we look at the perspective of Jesus, the answer would be no. No, that's why he made the claim. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except through me. More of what's not fulfilling me now is not going to fulfill me later. So Jason, where does that leave me? Well, I think this is the journey then that we're all on in life. The journey we face in the days ahead. The second thing, and I'm going to leave you with this point, life in Jesus is about making the move from A to D. A to D. Jason, what do you mean by that? That's a little confusing. Well, let me try to explain it to you this way. It's about, are you stuck in life on the outcomes of life, or are you finding life in the origin of life? Like, are you settling for a solution in your life or the solution in your life? Because that's the claim Jesus made. He didn't say, I am a way to God. I am a truth that you can believe in. I am a life that you can live if you want to. That's not what he said. He said, I am the, I'm the origin of it. I'm the source. It comes from me. I'm not just an outcome or an option in your life. I am the origin. If you want to get to God, it's me. If you want to see God, it's me. If you want to live life to the fullest, it's me and only me. I'm not a solution, I'm the solution. I'm not a choice, I'm the choice. I'm not an answer, I'm the answer. I'm not a hope, I'm the hope. I'm the hope for your marriage. I'm the hope for your future. I'm the hope for your peace, for your joy. Come on, somebody. Jesus is saying, no, 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 no. Don't approach me like I am a version of an outcome or an option in your life. I'm the origin. I'm not a help. I'm the help in your life. I'm not a refuge. I'm the refuge. I'm not a peace. I'm the peace. Jesus reminds us of this in the book of Revelation, Revelation 22. These are his words. Look, I'm coming soon, he says, and my reward is with me. I will give to each person according to what they have done. And then again, he makes the statement almost exactly in the same frame of text to move from A to the. He says, I am the Alpha. That means I'm the beginning. I started the whole thing. I am the Omega. I'm the end of the whole thing too. I am the first and the last. I am the beginning and I am the end. Come on, we've got to move from A to the in our life. That's the one step, the one thing that we can do today. We can do today. Well, Jason, it seems so complicated and life. No, no, no. Jesus said, I'm making it very simple. Remember, Thomas was confused that day. Just like sometimes we get confused. Jesus, I don't understand even maybe what you're saying in this moment. I'm trying to understand, but I don't even know what you're saying, so how would I know how to get there? Jesus said, you know the way. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes to the Father. No one goes home except through me. I think that leaves us with one conclusion, one simple conclusion today. Jesus has no desire to be your something. He wants to be your everything. He doesn't want to be a God to you. He wants to be the God to you, the way home in your life, the peace, the help in your life, the joy. He wants to be the origin, the source. He doesn't want to be your something. He wants to be your everything. Come on, today, I know for many of you, hearing these words right now, you know in your heart if Jesus is a option in your life or if he is the origin, if he is the thing. And as we wrap up today's service, I want to give you an opportunity today, all of us, just to reset our hearts, to reset our minds and say, Lord, forgive me for the times that I have made you a option or an option in my life. I don't want you to just be a something. I want you to be everything. Will you pray with me today as we wrap this service up? God, many of us spend a lifetime chasing our desires and we're left wanting. All the time we chase after these things that we think are going to fulfill and we hear these words, Jesus, that you said to us, that you spoke through your word to us thousands of years ago, and even now today, they're more applicable now than ever. Our desires always leave us wanting. We do often get confused, and we do have a deep desire inside of us to come home. So God, today I pray that you would forgive us for the times in life where we have made you a something in our life. We don't want you to be a something. Jesus, today, we want you to be everything. I pray today, God, that you would flood the hearts of your people today with your love, your grace, your mercy, with this welcome reminder that you are the way, the truth, and the life. You're not something in our life. You are everything. We receive that today. For those of you today that might be here at Church Online and maybe you've never begun a relationship with Jesus, I want to help you really quick. Just take a first step in the direction of him. Making Jesus your everything is about turning your feet towards Him. It's about more Jesus, less me. More of what hasn't fulfilled me, or more of what's not fulfilling me now, is not going to fulfill me later. The only thing that's going to get me home, the only way I'm going to see and experience God, the only way I'm going to live life to the fullest of what God intended it to be, is by making Jesus my everything. You can do that right now in a conversation between you and God. I'll lead you in that prayer right now. Just quiet your heart in this moment and pray with me right now. Just right there. Just say these words and mean them in your heart. Say, Jesus, I'm sorry. Thank you for paying the dear price for my sin on the cross. I don't want you to be a something in my life. Today, I want you to be everything. I open my heart to you in this moment. I invite you into my life. Thank you for forgiving me of my sin. I know I didn't earn it or deserve it, but you did it because you love me. I receive that love today. Fill me with your Spirit. Empower me to trust you all the days of my life, to make you my everything. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen.
Amen. Well, hey, what a close to this series. And leave it to Jesus to leave no doubt about who he said he was, the way, the truth, and the life. And if today you want to get the most out of this life, we know the solution is not found outside of Jesus. He's the only way to God. Now, if you prayed with Pastor Tucker to receive his gift of salvation, then please use that raised hand moment in the chat. Our pastors are ready to reach out, congratulate, and equip you as you grow in your faith. Hey, tomorrow starts our journey into the Bible plan, so don't hesitate to jump in with us, regardless of when you're getting this message. Nobody's perfect. Everybody's welcome to participate at their own pace, but get in the habit, get familiar with the Bible using this app. It's the place that we gather to grow and support one another Monday through Saturday. Hey, next week we move from the cross to the grave and from the grave to the sky. Come and celebrate Easter Sunday with us, and better yet, bring someone along with you. Make plans to connect with someone next week, whether you watch together in a living room or just online with your family at home. Have a great week, everybody.